What about curbside? So you added that earlier this year. Does that help? Have you seen a lot of lift there from guests?
Olo, Radius Networks, they did a phenomenal job in partnering with us because honestly, it was probably a 2021 or 2022 roadmap type of situation. But we knew March, April time period that this was something we needed to get behind and get behind it quickly. So partnering with my partners in IT, finance, operations, training, I mean, it was a Herculean effort to try to make this roll out quickly. And I mean, honestly, it's amazing. You figure you order, you get to the restaurant, your food is brought to your car within 2 minutes. It's a greens fee now. You see it in retail, you see it in restaurant. Right. It's just a means of doing business. It is the new normal.
Yeah, that's a shift that I think we'll continue to see and just see lifts as we go.
Absolutely.
Curbside pickup, do you see things like that also staying around, like just make curbside pickup easier?
Right.
Those curbside experiences and sort of the ease of use of curbside and some of the features that have been developed by Olo and other folks, do you think that that's something that will continue, or people want a touch experience?
I think people that get used to curbside absolutely love it. I think they're gonna stick around. You know, it's very convenient. It's just that, you know, traditionally, like the Chili's of the world would do curbside pickup, right? Fast Casuals didn't do. And I think that's gonna stick around. We just had a board meeting yesterday, actually. We're talking about it, and it's something that we're doubling down on.
Yep.
You know, we're sharing parking lots with other brands next to us, so we have the same map, being a good neighbor and sharing the parking spots. So I think those things are gonna stick around. What I'm very interested to know is tableside ordering, where you walk in and you skip the line altogether. You just sit down, order via the app, and then the kitchen knows that you're in the building and you're in this table. That's gonna be exciting, you know, to see what happens to Fast Casual. We still want to double down on the fact that our interiors are going to be amazing and music is going to be awesome and all of the above. Because we have the technology, we don't have to be building drive-thrus, but we do, in typical Miami fashion, do pickup windows and digital forward, right? So even in our P&L, right, we're talking about digital sales versus in-store sales and seeing what the impact is, what the labor is, and all of the above. So it's exciting, you know, virtual brands. We're talking about virtual brands, like how do we leverage the same location and expand our digital footprint like everybody else, but without moving away from the core of our business.
Digging in a little bit in terms of your usage of the Olo platform and, you know, our relationship as partners in this whole thing, like how do you see Olo helping enable where you are now and where you need to get to?
You guys have worked with a number of different customers, and then so you've created some features that we thought, that's really great, like price management, enabling, disabling our stores. Some of these like fundamentals, you know, we don't have to think about because they're just features that are there. And I think where the collaboration comes together, if I really think about it, is Panda at our size has some needs that other large organizations that are also your customers can benefit from. And so we have like weekly meetings within your team, and it provides us with a pipeline saying, what are some of those feature enhancements that can come that would benefit other customers as well? They'll either improve our guest experience, our operations side, the technical reliability, and how do we make the system better? And I think that's a win-win for everybody all around.
Having Olo allows us to attract new guests. We're gaining traffic, we're converting Rails orders onto Dispatch orders, and we're providing an experience that's omni-channel for our guests. And we're able to do that on our owned media, which is so important. We saw the opportunity to leverage Olo to drive new guests as well as give our current guests a premium online experience. This is not a tool where we partner with Olo and just forget about it, and it's working and it's turned on and we don't have to think about it. There is a high level of maintenance. You need someone managing it on the brand side.
Let's move to P.F. Chang's to go.
Okay.
Because I found, you know, preparing for this and recalling that you opened your first one on Fulton Street in the Seaport, which by the way, Olo's headquarters, two headquarters ago, was literally next door to that.
Funny.
So this kind of lovely little corner of New York, and you open a 1700 square foot takeout only outpost, but before COVID.
Yeah. PF Chang's To Go has been in the works for actually a couple of years, so it predates COVID. I think it just goes back to our organization's belief in the delivery business and what it could do for the brand and where it could go from a runway standpoint. And I think at the end of the day, it's just, it's aligned with consumer preferences and the way people continue to engage with restaurant brands. We've got 202 restaurants in the US. So when we do that math in terms of who we can reach from a household penetration standpoint, we can reach about 81% of US consumers. They live within one of our 89 DMAs. However, when you actually look at the percentage of people that are within 4 miles of a PF Chang's, it's actually quite small. So 79% of folks don't live within 4 miles of a PF Chang's. So for us, it's an opportunity to deliver the brand and reach people that we weren't able to reach previously, and it's a different model.
Well, not only did you open the to-go model in a interesting climate, but you did it in New York,
yeah,
where there's no shortage of Asian delivery
yes,
available. Have you been happy with the results?
We have. Our Manhattan launch has exceeded our expectations. We're, it's interesting. Some of the sites maybe play a little bit more to the office location, which obviously we couldn't have predicted a year ago when we were selecting these sites. But I think, we think at some point that volume actually continued to grow. But in terms of where it's opened at, we're very happy with the initial success and are very optimistic as we move forward. I will say that we've had to rethink our strategy, though, as we move forward. So a lot of the sites you'll see right now are more of an urban environment. We were playing to that like office catering occasion.
Sure.
We've had to pivot, and so we are going to be doubling down more in suburban locations going forward.
Yeah, I think we've been, we've found that the signals that you just mentioned, there's a lot of mixed signals, things we wouldn't have expected. One of the interesting things that we've continued to hear from our customers is that catering is still very high interest. It's very high on their priority list,
right,
to elevate their catering programs, new tech. They expect a return of catering. Maybe that's fanciful thinking. I'm just curious of how you think of catering in this space and time.
Yeah, I think it will come back for sure. We think it's an opportunity. We are actively working on continuing to upgrade the program itself. I think from a consumer standpoint, there's almost like a blurring between traditional takeout delivery and catering. I think that will continue to kind of co-mingle. Not necessarily a bad thing. I just think it changes the way we think about it and how we think about it from a marketing standpoint.
I'm curious to hear about a number of things. One, implementing tableside ordering. I also want to hear about implementing delivery through your own direct channel. Curious about your experiences.
Primarily, we always started with pickup. That kind of gave us a lot more of a good grounding for what the future would look like from there on. And as we added new channels with you guys, it was third-party delivery. So within a few months of COVID, we'd pretty much onboarded all of our partners into the Olo network. And again, that changed some of the operation because there was now delivery drivers, a lot more delivery drivers coming through. And then obviously when we looked at mobile dining, that was probably the real change, because that was the opposite. There's not as much, leeway when you're sitting down to dine. It's everyone needs to be, fulfilled very quickly. And it made us rethink how the space works as well, because a lot of our locations, were retrofit with ordering. So having couriers and drivers pull up to windows during a dining experience isn't great. So we had to rethink about where we position those, how do we get the flows of customers coming through the door.
Within digital pickup versus delivery, where are we now?
Digital pickup and digital delivery probably made up only 2% and 3%. Now pickup is 30 to 40% of our business, and delivery will make up 35% as well.
Wow.
On any given day.
And delivery transaction size, I'm guessing, is larger than pickup size or takeout size.
The cafe menu, we see a pickup of around $17 is the average ticket, and delivery is 27. And even in our own channels, we're seeing that up at 28, 29 for our native delivery, compared to third-party delivery as well.